So my name's Lars Kurth. I'm the community guy at the Xen Project. I also happen to chair the Xen Project Advisory Board, which funds the Xen Project within the Linux Foundation. And Russ asked me to give you a little bit of an update what's going on in the hypervisor. Maybe a little bit of introductory stuff and try and give the whole thing relevant to Unikernels as well, which is actually all quite hard to do in 30 minutes. So if it doesn't quite flow and there's some gaps in between, then that's because, you know, I've had to make choices. But I think it kind of sort of works. So as I'm a community guy, I sort of just wanted to sort of share some stats, you know, with you, which I find quite interesting. So, you know, what this graph shows you is, you know, the recent hypervisor release history. Oh, I spelled history right. That's good. And this kind of shows you, you know, how over the last few releases we actually managed to deliver more features, you know, per month. And, you know, that trend, you know, seems to be continuing. So that's good because, you know, more features actually means more good stuff for all you guys to use. If you start looking at hypervisor Git commits, oh. you sort of see that similar, actually what's really interesting is that for a long time we kind of, you know, we've been fairly stable, and then this year, last year, things really jumped, you know, significantly, you know, almost 40% more commits than in the year before. And I see that that trend continuing. Now what's really interesting about this is really, you know, it's showing there's more innovation. But what's happening at the same time is that the demands on the project are also changing, right? So we're doing more stuff, but actually everyone in the ecosystem requires that the whole thing is of better quality, and we also deal a lot better with potential security issues. And, you know, despite all that, you know, so the effect of that has actually been that it's harder to get code into the project, particularly for newcomers, you know, where it can sometimes be a bit disheartening because, you know, the number of review cycles in those cases keep on going up. So that's sort of just setting the scene a little bit. You know, more innovation, more stuff happening, and, you know, more goodness, which hopefully you guys can also then benefit from. So now to the, that's sort of just setting the scene, now to the introductory bit. So actually, first a quick question, who's familiar with the hypervisor and how it works? All right, probably about third, so I'm going to go a little bit through some of the architectural stuff. And then I'm trying to interleave it with some stuff which is relevant to Unikernels and throw some new things in it as well. So sensor type 1 hypervisor, and I call it a type 1 with a twist because it's kind of not quite like a type 1. And what does this mean, right? So at the bottom you have the hardware. There's, you know, memory, CPUs, I/O. Then we have the hypervisor itself, and it, you know, does things like, you know, setup configuration, it has schedulers, it deals with memory management, timers, interrupts. And then we have this thing, and that's kind of where the type 1 thing comes from, right? It sort of abstracts the hardware. If you look at a classical type 2, you would have your host operating system in there, and it interacts and creates the VMs in some way, shape, or form. So this is kind of now where the twist comes from, right? So the first virtual machine we have in the system, DOM0, is called DOM0 because it's the first one which gets started. And that runs the host kernel, which, you know, is Linux, so it can be one of the BSDs. And the main purpose of that of the kernel is really to provide you access to the low-level hardware. to the device drivers, I/O, and so on and so forth. It is also the main entry point to interact with the outside world. So we have these things called tool stacks, which then, you know, interact with your cloud orchestration stack or, you know, command line tool or whatever. That's how you control, you know, everything in the system. Then we have, you know, your typical guest VM. So I'm just showing one. You know, you might have a guest OS and your applications in there, or, you know, it might be a Unikernel. And these typically talk via the PV interface to the device drivers to the I/O. So there you have a pair of, you know, PV front-end drivers and back-end drivers which then talk to the hardware drivers, which talk to the hardware. PV? Oh, paravirtualized, yeah. Never. And then you just replicate this, you know, across the board. Now, that has some architectural advantages. You know, it's thin, gives you big density, and it makes it excellent, you know, for supporting a lot of small workloads, such as Unikernels. It's highly scalable, so you can run a huge number of VMs. Again, you know, very good for a lot of small Unikernels. It's also good for something called disaggregation. Actually, the same idea behind Unikernels is used within Xen as well. You can drive, you know, you can run individual device drivers or QMU and stuff like that within different VMs as well. And in some sense, those things are actually like Unikernels, right? So, you know, we have these things called stub domains, which is basically QMU running on top of mini OS, which is kind of, you know, a Unikernel. Then, of course, you know, this whole architecture has some security implications. You know, host OS is isolated within a VM. And then, you know, but let's not get distracted about that. You know, just it's well known that we have a lot of advantages in this area. One other real interesting thing, and I'll get into this in a little bit later, is that you can plug and play with schedulers. And that could potentially be quite interesting for, you know, different Unikernel workloads. But I'll revisit this a little bit later as one of the things which is interesting and where there also has been quite a bit of development in the last two releases. And, you know, then there's the whole idea of PV, which is fundamentally the basis for a paravirtualization. It's fundamentally the basis for Unikernels today. And it's really easy to implement a Unikernel base against, you know, PV drivers. And it's one of the reasons, you know, why Xen is the dominant platform for Unikernels today. It also gives you really fast boot times, which are necessary for a lot of Unikernel workloads. If you have any questions at any time, just interrupt me. Right. So that's kind of some of the basic stuff. And I wanted to look at some of the more interesting things and make this a bit more relevant. So I wanted to look a bit at the interface between Xen and Unikernels, mainly from the viewpoint of virtualization modes, you know, where they're going, and what the implications for, you know, Unikernel development might be there. And then there's going to be a slight call to action for some of you guys to maybe think about that, engage with the project, and make sure that this is going in the right direction, because, you know, the type of developers in who do the very low level stuff, and your needs might be slightly, you know, there's a different set of people, and, you know, our core developers tend to anticipate what you need, but they don't always get it right. So let's look at the different virtualization modes. So, you know, we have PV here. This is how it all started. Then hardware extensions came along. So the HVM mode was introduced, and then we started to optimize this along the time and make it better and faster. And what's really interesting is that this is actually today the fastest virtualization mode on Xen, if you look at benchmarks. This one is the one with the lowest latency and the simplest one in terms of implementation. So we kind of wanted to get to a point where you have both, you know, the fastest and the simplicity somehow, and this is how PVH was born. I'll get to that a little bit later. So, why is this not showing anything? Then it shows you, you know, when each version was introduced in the Xen version. And actually, you know, today, this is really where all the Unikernel bases, or the majority of all the Unikernel bases, interface with Xen. So, you know, both Rump Run and Mini OS interface with this mode today. There are other Unikernels like USV which use a different approach, but I think the majority use PV today. So let's look a little bit at the various trade-offs and where this might be going, right? So actually, this kind of table shows you how some of these things are implemented and kind of explain. So I'll just ignore those first two. So the top, those vertical columns show you what's implemented in which way. And, you know, if you look at this column, this is where you get most of the runtime performance from, you know, through hardware virtualization of, you know, of your normal operations. And that's where a lot of effort by chip manufacturers, Intel, and so on, that's where all the effort goes, and that's why to a large extent, you know, PVH is the fastest virtualization mode today. And then, of course, for I/O, you just want to use the PD driver, because in hardware, that's kind of not so optimal. Now, there, in a traditional power virtualization mode, we kind of do this in software, and that's why in a lot of workloads, PV is a little bit slower than PVH, PVHVM. this one here, boot and motherboard, that's kind of where you get the fast boot time from, right? So there, this is obviously done in this is kind of done in software together with some hardware support, and you have the whole setup process, and that's why that takes a little bit longer. So what we ultimately want to get to is get the benefits of both of these and marry them. So I wanted to explore a little bit why we went to that mode and what we did and how we can where this is going, because there's some changes coming in the next two releases. So the motivation behind PVH was fundamentally we want to basically be able to run DOM 0 as an HVM guest to get all this extra performance. You know, right now, DOM 0 also always has to be a PV guest. And the reason for that is, you know, if you look at this architectural model we had, if, you know, HVM today requires QEMU, right, to run. Now, if you want to boot up, if you want to boot up DOM 0, and you want to run QEMU in it, you would need QEMU to run QEMU, so you have a circular dependency there. So you, that's why you kind of can't do that, and that's why today, you know, the DOM 0 almost must be a PD guest. The real motivation behind that is, you know, performance. You know, if DOM 0 is faster, then all the other VMs become faster. So that's one of the reasons, and that gets us to the second point. You know, we want basically we want PVH to be as fast as HVM. So the initial approach which was taken there was to take an HVM container, which gives you all the hardware access and run PV in it. The problem with this is that there's a lot of restrictions which come from the PV in architecture, right? So, for example, everything's implemented in the software, you know, so you can't really play with, you know, for example, a guest can only run in protected mode. You can't, change modes after the guest has been created, and all sorts of other things. But actually those limitations aren't really strictly necessary for that mode. They're just there. The whole concept was also designed before all these extra quality and security requirements came in. So we implemented PBH as it is today, and then we found if we wanted to get all the features in place, we would need to add a whole lot of extra code, which is new code, and it isn't shared with anything else which already exists in the system. So last year, there was a big discussion in the community to see how can we actually fix this. And the way, like, if you look back at it, we took an HVM container and we put PV in it. So what basically we sort of thought about, well, actually, what if we just took a HVM and called it out and removed the dependency on QMU? And, that would mean it's actually exactly like all the other HVM modes. It has no QMU, so it doesn't have this sort of circular bootstrap problem. It can be run as DOM 0, and it should give you, all the other benefits. From an end user's perspective, it behaves exactly like what we did beforehand, with PVH. It's just implemented in a slightly different way. Now, this is already, this is already in 4.7, and it's really interesting because it's actually, we run benchmarks and so on. It's very fast. It boots up relatively quickly, but it's not completely finished. So basically, what we've done is we, PVH, we renamed it because it's actually not a PV thing anymore. It's really HVM with stuff taken out. And you can already try that in Xen today. So you just use a HVM guest and you choose device model version is none. Normally it's QMU, right? So it doesn't use any device emulation. And here you are. However, where are we with this? Well, it's in Xen Git today as DOM user port. It will be in the next Xen release. We will have a few decisions still to make about naming. How do we name it? How do we make it accessible to users? It does create a little bit of confusion, and we sort of need to manage this. Then, in the next release, there's already a DOM 0 prototype for FreeBSD. It works. There's no Linux implementation yet, so that's coming before that needs to be implemented before it's going to be fully available. There's some cleanup tasks required, and the interfaces aren't yet declared stable, but we're almost there. So there's discussion going on around validating all the interfaces, and the benchmark's already very impressive. So it's basically very fast. So here's what I kind of want you guys to do, the ones who who might be using this in the future. So currently this stuff isn't used as unikernel based, but it seems that this is the way forward in the future. So really, to make sure that that really works, is we need to make sure that the architecture actually works for you before we declare the API is stable. So give it a run, play with it, see what it does. MiniOS and RumpRun, haven't been ported to that yet. So we need to make sure that this actually can be done and is relatively easy. So in a lot of ways, and that creates an opportunity, avoid duplication. So in many ways, if I remember back, in the early days of the Unikernels, we had actually quite a few different MiniOS clones, which were different branches of MiniOS, and it took quite some time to resolve this and get it, all back into one version. And, by starting to get with this process right now, we'd sort of be avoiding those type of issues. So my call to action there would be, you know, work with us, engage with the project, and, you know, and see how it works, and, you know, give the developers who are working on that feedback. So that's kind of the, that didn't really work that well, did it, that whole part, but hey. So I wanted to look at some other things. Performance. That ties a little bit back to the modes I was talking about earlier. So in the last two releases, we had an awful lot of performance improvements in Xen. I'm just listing some of them here. So these were in, I'm not going to go through that in detail. These were in 4.5. This is stuff which came in 4.6. And actually that really made a big impact on a number of workloads. So if I look at the last published benchmark, so if you look at this one, this was a, you can get the detailed benchmark in here. This was a 4.2 Linux kernel with 10.4.5 and compared against QEMU. And it's really interesting that most of the benchmarks, you know, either Xen, you know, won them clearly. So if you look at this, this is like a two-third, one-third split. And this is even before a lot of the improvements which came, you know, in 4.6. So that's, you know, on the whole performance front, I expect that there will be a lot more activity, you know, and a lot more competition and benefits for Xen going forward. But, you know, a lot of this is mainly HVM, right? So all of these benefits are on HVM, PVH, and so on. Another area, schedulers. So I mentioned earlier that Xen has the capability to plug schedulers. And how does this really look, right? So there's a number of different schedulers which have different properties. And in the hypervisor layer, per host, now you can choose which scheduler you want. But it's actually even better than that. You could create a CPU pool and attach a different scheduler to it. Why is this relevant? Well, you know, you could, for example, have a number of very latency-sensitive unikernels and then choose a scheduler which works better for those workloads and kind of optimize your system in that way. So how does it look? You know, you say here you have your RTDS scheduler, here you have a credit scheduler, and fundamentally, you know, these VMs will use one scheduler and the other VMs will use another one. Then you can change the scheduler parameters, you know, per host. You could change them per CPU pool or per individual VM. And that gives you a whole lot of ranges for optimization of a, you know, of a complex system where you have lots of different parts which may be collaborating with each other. So this just shows you a table of the different schedulers which are available today. So the ones which are worth looking at, but possibly in the context of unikernels, are credit 2, because it's very low latency, and a low latency is important for unikernels. RTDS, which is actually really a scheduler for embedded and automotive use cases, may not be so interesting, but I don't know. You know, that if this is interesting, come to me and I can try and figure something out and get some, you know, get you together with some of the other scheduler people. Scheduler use cases. So the RTDS scheduler, that's one which is, you know, aimed at automotive use cases, latency sensitive, and, you know, guaranteed quality of service, so you know that in a specific time slice, you will get a specific time slice for a specific VM, and you can control this at a very small granular level. incidentally, this is also interesting for some cloud-based use cases, such as gaming, video decoding, and so on, or, you know, areas where you might... Another interesting areas where we started seeing this being deployed is by vendors such as Verizon, who have guaranteed quality of service. So they're doing this in hardware right now by choosing different kind of hardware buckets, but you could also do this in software using using scheduler technology. That's kind of the part on schedulers. So I just wanted to sort of give you a quick rundown on some other stuff which is going on in the community and then wrap up with a conclusion. I'm going to cover a little bit various areas a little bit superficially. So we've seen an awful lot of contributions around x86 hardware support in the last year and a half, predominantly from Intel. A lot of it is really specific, Xen supporting specific hardware features for specific use cases around NFV, optimizing your system, and so on. So rather than going into detail with that, you know, it's basically there's a lot of activity in this area, and what we are fundamentally seeing is, you know, this is actually really interesting. Just in the past, we saw Intel contributions hovering around maybe 1 or 2% of the entire community, and it shot up to about 7-8% recently. The same is happening in the ARM space. So ARM hardware is tracked very closely, and the project also runs a test lab, and we'll be adding ARM hardware, 64-bit hardware to it as it becomes available, and there will be a lot of activity in this year. And I guess, you know, also from the ARM, I guess for Unikernels, your guys are mainly interested in 32-bit and smaller devices today, but, you know, that's also going to provide future avenues for you. Another area where there's some activity is graphics. So I'm not going to show you this demo because we won't have the time, but there's been a lot of activity around graphics virtualization. It used to be called XenGT, but it's technology is now called Intel GBTG. And what this basically does is allows you to share a graphics GPU amongst different VMs. And, you know, like basically, each VM has access to a partition of the graphics VM. Now, this is already, so right now, part of this is still out of free, but most of it is in Xen today. It's in use by Xen Client and the upcoming Xen Server 7 version. Most of the Xen patches are already part of the tree, but there's some refactoring going on around Linux and QEMU, which might affect the stuff which is already in Xen. A similar approach is also being developed for embedded devices by GlobalLogic. They're reusing some of the code which Intel has developed for x86 for ARM-based architectures. And there was just a blog post showing some demos that sort of focused around embedded architectures. There's another interesting set of technologies called virtual machine introspection. So what that does, it basically, Xen has this API which allows you from within DOM 0, from within a dedicated VM to monitor what's going on in another VM. And these interfaces are called VMI interfaces. They started appearing in the last two releases. And that has some really interesting implications, how security can be handled in the cloud. So again, there's a link to a demo which you can watch once you look at the presentation later. So how does this work? The cloud security today, you have your typical system with DOM 0, and then you might have a number of agents running in each VM. Let's just say these agents is antivirus software, or some disk and memory scanner, or network monitor, or something like that. And that kind of it introduces a management overhead, but also, it means that all of those VMs might start doing virus checking at the same time, and that has an impact, on your system. Typically called antivirus storm. So how does this VMI approach kind of solve this, right? So actually what you have there is you have a new VM, basically a security appliance that has that uses that VMI interface, and it monitors a number of VMs. and you could have several of these security appliances which monitor different sets of VMs, and that's relevant, of course, if you have a multi-tenancy environment. There's also a hybrid approach possible where you have several agents, leaner agents which run, in those VMs, which then collaborate with that introspection engine. Now, again, there are some products being worked on by a number of security companies like Bitdefender, Novetta, and a few others. And some of these things will be coming to market this year. Well, the thing is, actually, you could run this in DOM 0, but then you're going to have, you're loading more stuff into DOM 0, which you don't really want. And also, of course, this is optimized for cloud deployment. So actually what you really want is you want to have a VM image which can be easily installed and managed rather than having to manually put something, in a VM, into DOM 0 and then deal with it. Right, so it's actually a lot. And then there's also this little lock thing here, which is also quite important, which is XFM is the equivalent of SE Linux for Xen. And it allows you to control, what that engine actually can do and what it can't, right? But that's a whole, there's a whole set of issues and interesting conversations around the topic, to be had. And I can only just, cover this superficially. A lot of other security features are also currently being developed. One of the things we've been last year, you may remember there was the Venom vulnerability, and following that were a whole lot of other QEMU bugs, and this has been rather annoying, for a lot of for people within the community. So basically, right now QEMU runs in unprivileged mode within DOM 0, that any QEMU vulnerability is basically a risk towards Xen. So what we decided to do is basically sandbox and deprivilege QEMU, but also the other emulation technologies within Xen to basically protect ourselves against QEMU vulnerabilities and to make the system more secure. So that's a direct, response to eliminate a whole class of, issues where we don't have a lot of control over. Another thing and that's coming in 4.7. Another thing which is being developed, but this will take several iterations to be complete, is hot patching based. The code word for is exploit. So what that means is if there's a security patch, it can basically be wrapped up in a payload, and deploy it on a running Xen instance, hypervisor instance. We can do this without rebooting the host, and that means that things like cloud reboots will be a thing of the past. In fact, some cloud providers have that capability already and are collaborating with the community on an extensible framework, and common technology to make this all happen. So we're starting with some simpler use cases and successively add less, less common ones. Then another thing which is also being, there's some work going on right now, is better configurability. So if you look at security, the more code you have, even if you don't use it, the bigger your attack surface is. So, a lot of, not everybody in the Xen community uses the same set of features. So, ideally what we want to end up with is have the capability to switch and remove code, both at runtime and at compile time, which aren't being used to reduce the risk. So there's some work going into 4.7 with kconfig, but actually we're going to look at the whole architecture to come up with a common approach to for the future, and I expect that will also go over several release cycles. And we're nearly at the end. Actually, I think I hope I could show that a project has a history of proactively innovating. The rate of innovation is increasing. That means more features, more quickly. The demands on the project are actually shifting quite a lot. So, there's a lot more focus on quality and security. And what I've been dealing with, particularly in the last year, is that has actually created tensions within the community, because we have a lot of newcomers which want to get their stuff in quickly, but then a lot of the more established players want to ensure quality and security are at the level as it was, or even that level is sort of increasing every single year. And that sort of led to conflict, in the to some people being more verbal, about this within the community, because there are all these, let's say, as a community, we haven't made conscious decisions about trade-offs. What's more important than the other one, and we're kind of going through this this process right now, to decide. When is a new feature more important than quality? Can we have mechanisms to facilitate the whole process? And that leads me that the project does have a track record of adapting to challenges and criticisms. Like some of the security things we've been working on, I've been showing recently as a direct consequence of some of those challenges. And I think. It's also, the best platform for Unikernels in the cloud, because, Xen is basically running most clouds today, and it has a lot of unique features, and there's a lot of innovation, going forward. And that's it. If any questions, please. Go ahead. Yeah, but the thing is, like, as an open source community, this doesn't work, right? And particularly in the world as it is today, if you don't innovate and you don't do new stuff, then you don't exist. You don't get any press releases. People think you're not relevant anymore. And then there's a new kid on a block who does more features. And how do you solve that, right? It's actually it's like this comes back to this whole finding the right trade-off between different things. And I think this is generally a challenge which we're facing as an industry today, because I think not all projects today, or, you know, all successful projects will eventually face that, you know, face that challenge. Now, if you add new features, then some people will, you know, you're adding new stuff, you're growing a code base, you know, if you do stuff too quickly, it might affect quality, you know. There's all these different trade-offs you have to constantly look at. And, you know, one of the lessons I learned is that you actually, you know, a lot of the times this stuff happens implicitly without actually having had a decision, you know, a discussion and a, you know, a conscious decision about it. And that's when you start to get problems. So, you know, you have to bring some of these things out in the open and then make some conscious decisions. And then things, then you get buy-in, you know, and people are actually happy with the direction you're going in. And I guess at some point, you know, all these Unikernel communities will have to face similar similar issues. It's all quite nice when you start and you can do all this cool stuff. And then once you have users, particularly when a big, you know, big corporate users, then things will become different. Any more questions? Well, there are a lot of tools out there, which, you know, like, I mean, you can use parsing tools. So you can't formally prove it, right? Particularly in a language like C, right? You might be able to prove some of it in some more modern languages, right? You can use fuzzing techniques to find issues. And we do know that, you know, some of the big vendors which use Xen, they do use fuzzing to try and identify issues. This is also, you know, what actually typically tends to happen is that some of them, they start a little project where they focus on some component, and then suddenly we get a whole bunch of vulnerabilities in, which were discovered by some of those fuzzing tools. And the same happens, you know, for other open source projects. And then you kind of get these, yeah, you know, a whole batch of security vulnerabilities that come at once. And then you get the whole, you know, if you're a popular project, then a media might pick up on it. And then, yeah, you know, somebody found 7 vulnerabilities in this area. It's actually bad. But is it really? It actually means somebody's looking for issues. And I actually have a talk on Friday which looks at this whole security, it's Friday today, on Sunday, which looks at this whole topic, comparing how different open source projects, you know, deal with this. It's actually shockingly bad in many ways, how we, you know, how as an industry we deal with this issue. There's a whole range of different approaches. They're often not really compatible, but that's, you know, come to my talk on Sunday. So on the individuals, it's the overall number of contributors is increasing. What I have, you know, so what keeps on happening is we keep on getting a spike of people who look like individuals, and then later on it turns out that it maybe was a startup in stealth mode. But there's a number of other interesting trends that did start, which have happened, particularly in the last year, in the last 2 years. So traditionally, Xen has been a very European and US-focused project, but predominantly European. There's a lot more contributions now coming from Asia, and particularly China. So the number of Chinese developers has gone up over the last 3 years from 2% to almost, you know, to 12%, right? And actually, I'm regularly going out to China to give training, because there's also interesting cultural challenges, you know, working with which sometimes lead to problems. Another thing I have started seeing, particularly in the second half, well, particularly last year, a lot more security companies are starting to build, to contribute to Xen. And as a reflection, in some cases we know that they're building products, and in some cases we know that they're doing something, but we don't exactly, you know, what they do. So it'll be interesting, you know, to watch that space as well. And then suddenly some new company names, you know, start appearing, and, you know, like one which started to become quite active recently, and they're quite, they probably also, they're also looking at some Unikernel stuff, potentially, you know, they're called Star Lab. There's a couple of other ones as well, which I know exist, but they haven't come out publicly yet. So I'm not going to share any information about those. And yeah, I mean that's sort of some of the some of the insights around contributions. There's some more, but come and find me afterwards. Any more questions?
Let's give Lars a big hand. And just for closing, I just want to say thank you all for coming out, you know, spending your Friday with us. Just show of hands, was this worth your time? There we go. That's what I wanted to see. That's cool. Thank you again. I do have a talk 3 o'clock tomorrow. Lars has another talk on Sunday. Please feel free to drop by. We thank you very much, and have a very good scale conference.